I'm Krishna Karwa, a senior research analyst with IFAS Financial India Private Limited. So equity markets are a catch-22 situation as of now. And amid this juncture, a lot of investors and advisors are wondering as to how allocations to the large, mid and small cap should take place. One category which helps you do that job effectively is multi-cap funds. It not only offers you steady compounding benefits that large caps seem to offer, but also meaningful exposure to the broader markets, that is the mid and small caps as well. By SEBI's mandate, such funds are required to invest a minimum of 25% in each large, mid and small caps. Amid all this, and given this context, IDFC AMC is launching its multi-cap fund. To understand their perspective on fund management and more, I have with me Mr. Dalen Pinto, who is the Senior Fund Manager for Equities at IDFC AMC. Thank you so much for joining in, Dalen. Glad to have you with us.
My pleasure.
Okay, so let's start off with your quick thoughts on the equity markets right now. We are in the middle of a very nervous phase where there is a QE taper underway by the US Fed, and a possibility of a rate hike also looms large. There are also a lot of concerns on global growth surfacing from time to time. So amid all this, what do you think about the equity markets, more specifically in India?
Yes, so, you know, Krishna, I think, you know, this is a question that we virtually ask ourselves every day. If we go back to March 2020, when, you know, the Nifty had, you know, touched about 8,000 once the COVID pandemic had just about started and was spreading rapidly across the world, I think at that point of time, you know, we were all worried that, you know, can the markets go further lower, you know, and what could, you know, what outcome could the pandemic actually have on us? And now that we are in the reverse situation and the markets are at about almost 18,000 on the Nifty, we have other problems to worry about. You know, what would the Fed do? Are valuations too expensive? You know, and questions like these. I think there's, you know, there's never a right time to invest in the market. When markets are low, we have a different set of worries. When markets are high, we have a different set of worries. And therefore, I think time spent in the market is far more relevant. And in every market cycle, we do see various sectors or a set of stocks getting overpriced. But at the same time, we do see value in various other sectors or a certain set of stocks which are underpriced. And I think that's really where, you know, stock selection plays a far more critical role, in especially in these times where it appears that, you know, the entire markets are on fire, everything seems to be overpriced or overvalued. And it would come down to underlying stocks and the fundamental strengths in many of these businesses, which would actually provide returns to investors over the next 5 to 10 years.
Absolutely, we concur. Would also like to know your thoughts more specifically on the mid and small cap space, which has seen a stellar rally since the March 2020 lows. And there are a lot of concerns again on their valuations.
Yep. So, you know, that's a great question because, again, you know, people do have, you know, very short memories. They look at the last 1 year and they think, you know, small caps have done exceedingly well. But if we just, you know, wind back a little longer, if you look at 2018 and 2019, mid and small caps had a very rough time. You know, so we went through a very bad patch for a little over 2 years. And it's from that low base that we've seen a very strong recovery in mid and small cap stocks over the last 12 months. I think the other more, even more important and relevant point is look at the earnings growth that many of these companies have started to deliver. And I think that is what the market has been far more optimistic on, is that earnings have come back very strongly in a variety of small caps and a variety of mid caps across sectors. And I think that's where the real optimism is actually coming from. And the prospects going forward do seem to be, you know, fairly good, given where we are in terms of the global GDP growth cycle. as well as where we are in terms of overall interest rates, right? And therefore, valuations, while they might look or appear expensive relative to history, I think we should also take cognizance of the fact that interest rates relative to history are also at all-time lows. And therefore, we have to look at, you know, both the aspects of valuation in the context of where global interest rates are today.
That's right. And we were also curious to know, now you did shed light on the earnings growth coming back in a big way after years of disappointment. In addition, what do you think, you know, besides the interest rates fact that you alluded to, what else can possibly provide long-term levers to re-rating for Indian equities as a whole?
That's a great question. And you know, I think there are three or four things that I'm fairly optimistic on when you talk about the next 5 or 10 years. And I think many of these are global trends. I think one is, you know, of course, just to start with COVID, you know, no one can really predict the future of health. But I think given where we are and the way humanity has actually, you know, fought this disease and actually come out of it in a large way, whether it's through vaccinations or any other medical help that has come through, I think that itself, you know, has put us on, you know, brighter prospects in terms of us now going out and leading normal lives, hopefully over the next 12 to 24 months. And I think that will change the growth trajectory for most economies across the world, because a lot of services are related to us moving around as compared to sitting in our homes, which is what we've been doing for the last 2 years. Right. So GDP growth outlook, I think, over the next couple of quarters is going to be pretty strong. And I think that's one level of optimism that we all have to look out for. The second aspect is, of course, you know, the world is changing. A lot of people are now getting far more cognizant of the environment. You know, green energy is a buzzword that's very widely used today. And while everyone wants to breathe better air and live better quality of life, there has to be massive investments that need to be made in this space. And we believe these investments are just at the start. And this is going to be a multi-year cycle of investments that probably kickstart a global capex cycle, something that's been missing over the last decade or so. Right? I think the third thing, you know, for India in particular, I think we've embraced not only the advent of green energy, and I think the government has put out some fairly solid policies on how we should look at this particular sector going forward. But I think we've also been fairly opportunistic in terms of trying to figure out, you know, how can we be a supplier to the world? How can we use the strengths that we have as a large domestic economy and use that scale to actually not only provide goods and services to ourselves as a nation, but also to the rest of the world? And schemes such as PLI and various other policy documents that have come out, I think are a right step in that direction. So I think, you know, these are two or three multi-year trends that I think keep me optimistic. And that's why, you know, we remain fairly bullish that earnings growth is going to be the strongest that it has ever been in the last decade, going into FY22 and FY23.
Glad to hear that. And I'm sure a lot of investors will also take note of these multi-year trends. So in order to capitalize on these, stock selection obviously becomes important. So in this context, how would IDFC be looking at things both qualitatively and quantitatively? Now, that's one. And second, between value and growth, which of the two themes would you be more tilted to?
So I think, you know, we have certain internal filters that we look at when we decide on stocks. You know, I think management pedigree, track record, governance, return of capital, either in the form of dividend or buybacks, you know, balance sheet leverage, and operating cash flow yields. I think these are, you know, the 5 or 6 key indicators that we use to try and screen, you know, stocks, be it large, mid or small, right? On the value versus growth strategy, I think a lot of that depends on what market cycle we are in. With regard to IDFC Multicap Fund in particular, I think we're going to go with the blended strategy where we will focus on growth and value. I don't think we want to really choose one over the other at this point of time. I think there's plenty of opportunities in both. And you know, both segments do appear attractive to us. But of course, it ultimately does all boil down to the stock picking. I think that's where we want to be most active in terms of choosing the underlying stocks.
All right. Now, another important question here is, we've seen a slew of IPOs of all types, right? From new age businesses to those pertaining to the old economy sectors. So how do you perceive this market right now? Because once again, out there's been a lot of talks about valuations being elevated and growth already priced in. So we'd like to know your perspective on that.
No, I think the IPO market is having a great time. I mean, it's probably the best market that we've seen in the last decade or so. I think one has to be cautious, one has to be careful, one has to be very selective in the kind of businesses and the price that you're willing to pay. So I think that is something that we all have to be a little watchful of as investors. But having said that, you know, there are also some fairly outstanding businesses that are coming to the market, you know, businesses that we haven't been exposed to earlier. There are also certain sectors where, you know, there is a very small representation in the current markets, right? And therefore, you know, a few more companies that come into the sector, you know, actually give us more color and more ability to look at, you know, different sets of businesses within a particular sector, right? And different sets of managements within a particular sector. So I think to that extent, it's always a great learning process. But given the heat of the market, I think one does have to be cautious and careful and choosy about what they select. The other thing that I really like about the IPO market is that it gets a lot of capital towards the equity markets. And this capital is usually then funneled by promoters, either as growth capital for those respective companies, or in the case of offer for sale, it provides a release of capital to the erstwhile promoters or to private equity funds who are exiting. And then that capital gets back into the system in some form or the other. So I think it's a great way to actually attract more capital towards the markets, which ultimately will fuel growth in some form or the other. I think that's what I'm far more optimistic about, rather than just the underlying opportunity of being able to invest in many of these businesses.
Sure. Dalin, so apart from the typical large, mid and small caps that the fund will be investing into, is there any scope for some foreign stock exposure as well over a period of time?
Yeah, so, in our allocation, I think we've been fairly disciplined in how we have thought about it. I think we are all aware that the markets have been doing well for quite some time. You yourself pointed out mid and small caps have been on quite a run over the last year or so. So when you look at our asset allocation, I think what we're trying to do is we're trying to build a portfolio that stands the test of time. So I'm looking at 5 years plus. That's the first part. And in that context, you know, we are looking to have a very judicious mix of large, mid and small. And when I say judicious mix of large, mid and small, we all know that most people are very comfortable with you going and buying as many large caps as you would like in a fund. But it's the mid and small cap aspects that sometimes do worry investors about. And it worries us as well. Having experience of running funds which do go across market caps, I can assure you that it's in the bad times that people really start to look at whether mid and small caps should be a part of the portfolio or not. And in that context, we have made sure that irrespective of how euphoric markets might be, we have put upper limit caps on both our mid cap and small cap allocations at 35 and 30% respectively, right? So I think that's the first part of discipline that we have, you know, tried to inculcate in the fund strategy. And that completely eliminates fund manager bias to that extent, right? The second is on, can we look at other markets? And foreign markets are usually very, very attractive. They're a great hedge, especially when when the Indian markets are not doing well, right? And we've seen that in times when Indian market or the economy is not doing well and the rupee is under pressure, it is the Western markets that outperform the Indian markets by a wide margin. And therefore, we have kept an allocation up to 10% for international securities or funds. And we would utilize, that allocation depending on what our view is on the overall global macros as such.
That's an interesting feature. And one of the few funds, I believe, in this category, which would offer this differentiating advantage.
That's right, yeah.
And much needed also in today's times where diversification is something everyone is harping on.
Absolutely, yeah.
Okay, so coming back to the IDFC Multicap Fund, we'd also like to understand your view on how funds like these can be integrated in one's portfolio.
Yeah. Wonderful question. You know, we've done analysis on the markets now for many years, and we've always found you know, two or three issues that you know, investors always have a problem with. I think the first question is, most investors come and ask us, is now the time for small caps, or is now the time for large caps, right? And a lot of us keep getting confused on, you know, whether large caps are going to do well over the next 12 months, or are we going to have another great year for small caps? And these questions become very difficult to answer on a day-to-day basis. And I think a fund like a product like a multi-cap product, what it does is it provides an investor an opportunity to own the three asset classes at every single market cycle. And it completely eliminates the fund manager's bias towards a particular asset class. Because like you rightly said, you have to hold at least 25% in large, mid, and small at all points of time, irrespective of whether that particular segment is doing well or not in the market, right? So I think it gives a very balanced exposure, a very complete exposure, where an investor can just choose one fund instead of having three different folios and three different products, right? And it really removes, you know, one big hassle of a decision that an investor really has to take. So I think that's the most important feature or function that a multi-cap fund provides. The second is, we've done analysis of multi-cap funds and some of the other categories, such as flexi-cap and large mid. And what we found out is that in most of the categories, we've seen that a lot of funds are more skewered towards the large cap portion, you know, which is also related to the benchmark that many of these funds are following. Whereas if you look at the multi-cap category, the index is designed in such a way that 50% is the maximum large cap, you know, allocation in the index. And then you have a 25% allocation to mid and small as well. So I think by virtue of the way the index is constructed, I think fund managers themselves not only have limits of minimum 25-25, but I think the upper limits also automatically do get capped, you know, basis of how the index is constructed as well. So I think it's a very differentiated product. It's a very center of plate product for an investor who doesn't want to decide and doesn't want to keep choosing between large, mid and small, you know, every 3 or 6 months, depending on how you know, the market is behaving. But the only caveat I have is that you have to come in with a long-term view. We would love you to come with a 3 to 5 year horizon, if not longer, because I think that's the minimum time horizon required, especially when you're playing in mid and small caps, because a lot of these companies do need time, you know, to grow their businesses, to go through one or two cycles that do come every 2 or 3 years, and to really give you the alpha that you're looking for in this particular segment.
True. So keeping all of these points that you mentioned in mind, can you also touch upon the NFO details in terms of the subscription period and the minimum amounts required?
Yeah. So the IDFC Multicap Fund NFO opens on November 12th and is open until November 26th. So it's a 2-week window for investors to come in. I think the minimum investment is 5,000 rupees. You could also come in one time or through an SIP. I think my preferred route personally is a combination of both, where even if you do come in with the FD, you know, one time, I think a follow-on SIP is a must for this product. And simply because when you have a large allocation to mid and small, the market does offer you wonderful opportunities on a correction to actually top up. And that's when, you know, the real alpha return starts to kick in. And therefore, I think it's important that an SIP follow through is also done in a product like this.
So, Dalen, thank you so much for taking out time and explaining the product to us. I'm sure a lot of the points that you stated will be particularly helpful to investors in making the right investment decision.
Thank you. Thank you for having me on the show. Thank you.
Yeah. So thank you very much, viewers, for tuning in. Watch out for our next video on another topic. We shall connect and touch base with you pretty soon. Goodbye.
Mutual fund investments are subject to market risks. Read all scheme-related documents carefully.